Hallelujah. Everybody just raise your hands towards heaven and say, Lord, thank you for joy unspeakable. And full of glory. Hallelujah. Say, Lord, we thank you for your peace that passes all understanding. And we thank you that you cause us to know the love of Christ. Do we get to experience that peace and that love right now? And find ourselves dwelling in all your fullness. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that everything that belongs to the Holy Ghost will begin to take place in this meeting here tonight, and that the things that have been just nothing more than religion, been nothing more than that which man can do, will cease to exist. That every person in this place who decide tonight that they would rather have the glory, Lord Jesus, that you gave to us from yourself when you poured out your Holy Spirit upon your church, rather than all the things that go on in the world of men. Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name for change. Father, I ask you for change right now. Father, I ask you for change right now. I ask for the miracle change right now. In the name of Jesus, the miracle change right now. Father, we thank you for the glory that has been given to us that belongs only to you. Father, we pray tonight that somehow a change would take place in every person's heart, even almost on the scale if they were not willing even, that there would come such a breakthrough because of your glory, your mercy, your manifest presence, that everything would begin to be redefined for ourselves, for the functions of our own lives and for our understanding, Lord, of who you are. Oh God, we praise you, we worship you, Lord. We bless and praise your holy name, Father. Father, I thank you for your mighty acts right now. I thank you for your miracles and for your signs and wonders. I thank you for the word of knowledge, Father, and the word of wisdom. Father, we thank you for the discerning of spirits, for the working of miracles, for the gifts of healing. All these things that belong to you, Holy Spirit, we thank you for prophecy, for tongues, for interpretation of tongues. Father, we thank you for the authority of heaven. Right now, in Jesus' name, the authority of heaven, the authority of your divine power and glory right now in Jesus' name. Upon every soul, upon every life. In the name of Jesus. Father, we pray that every eye would be open, every heart would be able to understand what you did when you sent to us the Holy Spirit. That every person can come now and begin to realize that there is a different kind of life that we can live right now in this earth. It's this life that belongs to you. Father, we pray, God, that your people would quit struggling with the whole idea and the notion and act as though it's some kind of a burden, too much to carry, and act like it's some kind of a trial when you gave to us heaven. When all we had was hell. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask you, Lord, in your mercy, cause us to see it, Lord, like you produced it, like you purposed it, Father. And Lord, we recognize that in many people's minds, things might actually even have to be redefined. So do that, Lord. Redefine things, we pray in Jesus' name. Just I want everybody in this place, I want you to lift your hands towards heaven because I want you to feel and experience the manifest presence of the Lord, because without that, there's only religion. Without relationship, there's only religion. Without the Holy Spirit, and in interaction with the Holy Spirit, there can't be a relationship, because he's brought to us the ability to interact with the Lord Jesus Christ. He's brought to us the ability to interact with the Father. We have access to the Father. We have access to God by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 in verse 28, he said, now God has put in the church apostles, prophets, teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, and diversity of tongues. And you have to understand, unless these things are freely allowed to operate, there's no church. There's no church. We don't have what God intended us to have. There's not going to be the miraculous revelation, the presence of Jesus, the growth and the maturity, the God's purpose for our life. Father says to us by his servant Paul in the same chapter, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, he said, for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to every one of us, so that we may profit by it. For to one is given the Spirit, the word of wisdom. And to another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. This is what he placed in the church. This is what's in the church. You're not having church without this. People want to have church without this. They want to make church. You know, the Lord spoke to me and said, church is not about preaching and singing. It's about flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces the preaching and the singing. And somehow there's an unwillingness to give place to the Holy Ghost. And the Lord wants us to just get relaxed about his life. You know, Father wants us to lose our life, not so that we suffer and be in pain and agony, but so that we can get his life. He wants us to stop doing the stuff that we're holding on to and have such security in, so he can go ahead and give us something far greater than anything that we could ever begin to think or ask. And somehow, you're going to have to get yourself some wisdom. Quit struggling with the program, holding on to something that really can't last for long. It's like a vapor. It's like a flower of the field that springs up, and it looks really good for a little while, but it's soon gone. It's like the flower of the field that withers away. Man, at his best is his glory at his best. Huh? Man, I tell you right now, I pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you get old and wrinkly and gray with the glory of God, having fully lived your life for Jesus Christ, rather than sitting there, you know, with a bunch of regrets. Because ultimately, you're going to get a wisdom to recognize that of what really is important, and that most of the things that people value in their life for the majority of their life really isn't important at all. So tonight we pray God give you revelation about how to let the Holy Ghost come take over and begin to give you wisdom and begin to give you insight. Amen. Yeah. The Lord talks to us also about the working of miracles and prophecy, the discerning of spirits, and many different kinds of tongues, diverse tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. And when you got going on, and then it begins to be
where then it excels into interpretation of tongues and even excels into prophecy, then you've got the very beginnings and the foundation of how the church works and how the church functions. Because that's what we see in Acts chapter 2. That's how it all began. You can be seated. That's how it all began. It began any other way. People could say, well, you know, we're if the church would have began with everybody just sitting around and just, you know, looking at one another or listening to one person preach or minister and just tell a story or give their insights concerning the Word of God, then somebody could say, well, we've gone back to where it was in the beginning. But that wasn't the way it was in the beginning. The church was born in the fires of the Holy Ghost. Father said, go, tarry. Jesus said, go, tarry until you receive the promise of the Father. Go, tarry until you're endued with power from on high. Hallelujah. And he likened, Jesus likened that unto rivers flowing out of our innermost being, an inexhaustible flow of the presence and the life and the power and the glory of God. It's what we like to teach you tonight. Would you like to learn?
Yes.
You know, the Holy Spirit has come. He's devoted to teaching you these things. I mean, obviously, he's a much better teacher, I'm certain, than we are being examples of. Maybe we're just not the prize students, you know, or something. But, you know, we want to change that. We want to begin to participate with what the Holy Spirit is doing, because he's come to lead us, to guide us into all truth, to take everything that belongs to Jesus and reveal it to us, transmit it to us, disclose it to us, show us how to function and operate in it. Jesus said, you cannot be my witnesses, and he's talking to the people that lived with him for over 3 years. He says, you cannot, and he was talking to his mother, too. His mother was there in the number of the 120. And, of course, you know, at this point in time, too, he's talking to more than 500 brethren. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, there was more than 500 brethren that was around. Only 120 made it to Pentecost. Only 120 was there waiting until finally the event took place. But look at the glory. Hallelujah. Look at the glory. He says to them, you cannot be witnesses unto me and unto my resurrection. Because he doesn't want us to give some lifeless presentation of God. Say, oh God, the kingdom of God has begun. Christ Jesus is the King of Kings. People don't know that. People think somehow kingdom of God's going to come in the future. Christ Jesus has already been coronated King of Kings. He's already been exalted Lord of Lords. And he said it's going to happen in the future. And then we're going to come along, give some lifeless, powerless presentation that Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, God Almighty manifested in the flesh, who died and was buried and went down into hell for 3 days, rose up by the power of the Holy Ghost, has ascended up into heaven. Hallelujah. Seated at the right hand of the Father, made far high above all principality, power, might, and dominion. And we don't have any proof to provide? Well, that's just ridiculous. We're just going to basically sit in a number of religion and kind of find ourselves in a category with everybody else of religion. Religious power, you know, everybody, all the religions got their book, all the religions got their teachers, all the religions got their followers. But who has power, the very power of God, to represent the life and the ministry of a living and very present Almighty God who now exists in the midst of his people by the power of the Holy Ghost? It's about time somebody makes the Holy Spirit something bigger than what he's been up to this point in your life. That he has more influence on you than your desire to have a meal. And that has a continual calling effect on most people. Yes. And or your continual desire to have something to drink, your thirst. Father wants to move into our lives and begin to cause within us an appetite for heaven, an appetite for the kingdom. Amen. Begin to produce within us a different kind of a hunger and a different kind of a thirsting. Amen. And when that hunger and that thirsting is there, he comes and fills us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All we need tonight, somebody says, what is it going to take for me to move on with God? Just a little bit of hunger and thirst. What is that going to take? Just a little bit of abandonment to start seeking first the kingdom of God and stop seeking everything else that all the nations seek after. The Lord said, don't seek after a job. Don't seek after what you're going to wear and the houses. Don't seek after that. He said, I'll provide that for you. People act like somehow we're going to get a bunch, you know, that we're to. It seems to me that some people think that when we begin to declare these wonderful good things, good tidings of the Lord, that somehow people think that we're going to basically, you know, expect that they go ahead and give us everything that they have and then take on some, you know, white sheet that we're going to put a hole in it so they get room for their head to go through and a couple of hoses for their arms, give them a pair of sandals, and they got to walk around, you know, basically destitute, barren, and hungry and starving for the rest of their life. And, I mean, that's about, someone says, when we start talking about losing your life, that's about the response that I think that we get out of some people. When we start talking about take up your cross and follow him, deny yourself, it seems to me that that's what people begin to think. No. The Lord's trying to get you out of the way so he can move in.
Amen.
He's trying to get your stuff out of the way so he can give you his stuff.
Hallelujah.
He wants to create for you a great exchange, an exchange of your life for his life. And it's not very difficult. Hallelujah. It's not difficult at all. He has provided the power and the ability for us to do everything that he's asked us to do through the authority of his word and by the power of the Holy Ghost. All you and I have to do is be willing to cooperate with him, be continually filled with the Spirit. As Paul said to the church at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, all we've got to do is be willing to let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. As he said to the church at Colossae in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16. And to have these wonderful results going on in our life where we're singing, and hallelujah, spiritual song, hymns and psalms and spiritual songs, hurra basta keri. Hallelujah. Mandolo borethea. Hallelujah. Haramondesite, spiritual songs. You know, Paul says, and when he talks about the order of the church in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and he's talking about the beautiful roles of tongues, especially in the church, which people want to deny and then still have the moving of the Holy Spirit. He says, first of all, he said, I would that all of you spoke with tongues. And then he says, I speak in tongues more than y'all. I like to highlight those two verses of scripture because nobody else highlights them. You know, it's just like they pass over them. You know, at the very beginning, he said, I would that all of you spoke with tongues. And then later on in the chapter, about verse 19, he says, I speak in tongues more than you all. And just helping us understand the beauty and the splendor of this that was poured out by the gift of the Holy Ghost when they say Ramon de Gishtiberadei begin to be issued forth right out of the bellies of men, where that we can begin to learn to speak the words of God rather than the words of men. You spent your whole life being taught how to speak the words of men, speak things that make sense, speak things that will cause people to like you and not think that you're stupid. You know, and not speak silly words, but speak words that, you know, everybody can feel good about or whatever. Now the Holy Spirit wants to teach us to speak the words of heaven. Yeah. And so he's got to mess everything up, as it were, and begin to speak out of our lips and out of our bellies these diverse tongues, these tongues, as it were, of men and of angels, these tongues of heaven, this language of heaven. Hallelujah. Did you know that Jesus spoke on tongues? Many people don't know that Jesus ministered on the gift of tongues. They don't really, that was Jesus highlighted as one of the most important things. Did you know that? In Mark chapter 16, verse 17, he says, these signs will follow them that believe, or the true believer. He said, in my name they will cast out devils and speak with new tongues. In other words, in the word that is used there before in the Greek language is tongues that have never been spoken before. Somebody said, oh, he's talking about, you know, speaking in all the various different languages, human languages that men understand. No, that's not what he's talking about, because he's talking about something specifically by the Spirit of God that takes an interpretation by the Spirit of God. It's a language that comes by the Spirit of God, and it takes a miracle interpretation by the Spirit of God to know what that was that was spoken by the Spirit of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so he says furthermore that it makes it distinctive and contrasts it between human language and the language of the Spirit. When he begins to say, what should we do then? He said, we're going to pray in the Spirit, and we're going to pray in the understanding also. Now, demarcating the difference between that which the Holy Spirit would speak and that which men could speak out of the realms of the Spirit, still once again, that other men could understand, speaking of the human language, or rather the languages of men. Are you with me? You understand what I'm saying? He said, then what shall we do then? We will also sing in the Spirit. And he already defined what it means to sing in the Spirit. He said the tongues, the language is speaking in the ministry of the Spirit, speaking in the Spirit. And now people want to just ex-nay that. They want to eliminate that. They're going to be all embarrassed about that. All of a sudden, you know, we moving with God. God's always had a minority moving with him. God's never had a majority. God's never had huge, gigantic churches. He's always had real small ones. And this is just the way it is. Jesus has never fit into the populist opinion. He's never fit into the majority opinion of anything. And as soon as people start getting all uppity about who he is, he says stuff like, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Somebody told me, a preacher told me the other day, said, I believe that if I could just be a little bit more of a better communicator, I wouldn't offend so many people. I said, well, it seems like that Jesus had your same problem. You know, as soon as things started getting big, he said stuff that nobody could understand. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. And his disciples said, this is a hard thing. It's hard saying. How can you tell us to eat your flesh and drink your blood? He said, basically what he brought it down to is, he says, I'm just proving you, basically. And he comes down and says, he that abides in me, he lives in me and lives by me, he's the one that drinks my blood and eats my flesh. Amen. This communion, this holy fellowship that we have, that goes beyond just the elements of communion. It goes beyond just the juice of the vine that comes from the grape of the vine, or the bread that represents the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a communion by the Holy Ghost. And that your life, that you live it and pursue in your life in your own interest, is going to get in the way of. And so the Lord tries to point them out, and tries to identify them, and he tries to bring you to a place where you'll come and you'll put them on the altar of sacrifice and give it on over to him. He's got a promise for you, but they don't want that promise getting in the way of your relationship with him, because he's got far more better for you than just the few promises that you know and understand. I mean, I believe that if Abraham would have done it like many of God's people do it today, my goodness, this would have been one long, drawn-out affair of taking Isaac up to Moriah. You know what I'm saying? That had got started a couple of 40 or 50 times, and then went back to the house. You know, need to pray about it, think about it a bit more. No. When you begin to walk with the Lord the way that he wants us to walk with him, as we obey him, he unveils his glory to us. You know, revelation comes by way of obedience. God retains all right to revelation, and if you will obey him, the more you will obey him, the more that you will be able to see and understand the things of the Spirit and the things of the kingdom. People sit around all locked up in their own interest, pursuing their own interest, trying to have the wonderful realms of God's divine power and glory and flowing the Holy Ghost too. You can't have both. You're going to have to give up on one. I mean, you know, my goodness, you got a compromised situation. You're straddling the fence of life and death, of human existence and divine existence. And Father's called us over into a realm of divine existence. Yeah, living by the Holy Ghost is divine existence. People say, oh, I don't understand what he means about divine existence. Living in the Holy Ghost, being led by the Holy Ghost, walking in the Holy Ghost, hallelujah. I just want you to understand that the life that you now live in the flesh can begin to take up such a precedence and such an importance in your life that you won't ever understand the mind of the Spirit. You won't understand the mind of Christ. You never understand what it means to put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. You'll never understand this glory of being endued with power from on high. You never understand this wonderful privilege of putting on the new man, which is created after his own image and righteousness and true holiness, because you're too busy with the other things that God told you get rid of, to let go of and not take any interest in it, because he'll take interest enough for you. I've discovered that I took care of myself for a big portion of my life, and then I quit taking care of myself and let God start taking care of me. And I'm telling you right now, I'm a witness along with many other people that God takes far better care of us than we take care of ourselves. I mean, he wants us to step into a miraculous realm of provision. He wants us to step into a miraculous realm of abundant life in every dimension of life. Abundant life. That's what a salvation is, you know. We think of salvation, people talk about, do you want to be saved, or have you been saved, or I'm saved? And then, you know, there are particular definition and ideas that people have associated with that. But the Lord calls that, in the Greek language, for example, zozo, and it talks about every dimension of life, the life of God, having been received by us. I have received every dimension of the life of God in the area of my spirit, the area of my soul, in the area of my body. My body is this temple. Though my body is corruptible and it's going to the grave, nonetheless it is a habitation that the Lord is well pleased to dwell in, so that Paul said, know ye not that your temples, that your bodies are the temples of the Holy Ghost? Think about how you ought to behave yourself and how you ought to act. That Father has come and taken up residence presence and the inside of you and I. He's left the place of dwelling, as it were, with men in temples made by hands in a place called the Holies of Holies. That veil was rent. Hallelujah. God has come, moved into the temple of our own life and of our own heart. But if we're not willing to do what he says, we're never going to experience the glory and the revelation of it, because we're holding on to stuff that's literally doubt and unbelief, waverings, literally waverings. The Greek word, which is a word that says diakrathos, which is to have two judgments, or really, it's really just two judgments, to dichotomize judgment, to have two judgments. I have a judgment about how I ought to live my life, because after all, I live in the world of men, and you know, God expects us all to take care of ourselves, and he's given us wisdom to figure everything out, or whatever the thing it is that we will say. And then I also have this judgment that somehow I'm living in the kingdom of God, and that now I'm led by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit. My whole life is about living in Christ Jesus. You can't have two judgments. That's wavering. That word diakritos is either translated doubt, is translated doubt most of the time in the New Testament, or is translated wavering. And I like to use the word wavering because it helps people understand what doubt's about. You know, it's just not having just two different opinions. You want to grab a hold of one opinion that what God said is true, and you can believe it and put it to the test, and that God is going to be faithful if you'll stand and do what he said. Yeah. If you're willing to be with total abandonment, trust him. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And listen, I'm telling you right now, Father, I give you some time to, you know, get warm up to the idea that he is trustworthy. He will. But I mean, after 30 or 40 years, I mean, I'm telling you right now, if you ain't got it by then, I don't think you're going to get it. Are you listening to me? There's something going on. There's a poison in your spirit that needs an antidote. Hallelujah. There needs a miracle. There needs to be a change that take place within your life. And it is with a total abandonment. Just start telling the Lord that you just consecrate your whole life to him, that this life that you now live in the flesh, you live by the faith of the Son of God. You know, that you're now living in this realm that has been given to us, Peter said, we are partakers of the divine nature. Hallelujah. We have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, and now we're living in glory land over here. Okay? We're living in the Jesus kind of life. We're living in the Spirit kind of life. We're living the God kind of life. That is the eternal life. Jesus is personified by John in the first epistle of John as eternal life. He personifies eternal life. He personifies life. Life. Eternal life is just a more full description, or a quantitative measurement of the very life of God. It's a quality of life that is abundant life, and it's a quality of life that is shown to us by the life of Christ Jesus. It's the fullness of life. It's life that has no death in it. Does that sound like good life? Yeah. Well, you're going to have to let go of your life. Yeah, you're going to have to. I'm telling you, I know it's so sweet. I know it's so sweet. Some people should sing the song, it's so sweet to trust in me. And some people should sing the song, I surrender half to you, Lord, half for me. I surrender half. But, you know, if we did that, then we would know that, you know, we're really wrong, our doctrine's wrong, our position before God is wrong, and then we'd have to begin to deal with ourselves. So what we do is we try to just kind of bury it, you know, and act like it doesn't really go on. I'm going to tell you what you want to begin to do is you want to begin to talk to Father in a very personal way after the manner in which he put his words in our mouth and which he has talked and spoken to us, and begin to say, Father, if you don't know how to hate evil, you begin to say, Father, teach me to hate evil, because this is what Father has come to do. He made a way to where the pseudo-sovereignty of Satan's power reigning over you and blinding you from the things of God and hindering you from knowing God has been removed, so that now everybody can be taught of God. And this is what the Holy Ghost is teaching us, and that is he's teaching us to abide and live in Christ Jesus, live out our lives in Jesus Christ. This is what the Spirit of the Lord is here teaching us. Praise the name of the living God. Hallelujah. I mean, just to get you into a place where you begin to embrace that and accept that. That it's a free gift. Somebody feels like they got to earn it. You don't earn it. You embrace it. You accept it. You willingly go and say, I'm crucified with Christ. I no longer live. Yeah. And you begin to talk to Father, Lord, teach me how to hate evil. Yeah. And he'll teach you how to hate evil and love righteousness, because that's just what, hallelujah. Yeah. That's what the Holy Ghost does. Isn't he good? He's wonderful. He perfects everything that concerns us. You meet, talk to him, begin to talk to him and say, Lord, I don't want to lose my life. I really think mine's grand. I think my life is so spectacular. And it really provides so well for me. And it's doing such a great job. I'm just so happy with my life. But I know that you want me to hate my life in this world. And I just want you to understand I don't. I love it. But I desire to understand how to hate my life in this world. And I mean, people just need to get honest with God. They just need to get honest. You can't play pretend with God. You can deceive yourself, but you can't deceive God. You can deceive people around you, but you can't deceive God. I mean, just might as well, instead of running and hiding at the presence of the Lord, you might just come clean. Just stand there in the presence and say, yep, I'm naked and I blew it. And I need some help here. And because he's come to clothe us. He's come to help us. He's our perfecter. He's our helper. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He comes with all of these things. He just gives them as a gift. And all of a sudden, what's going to happen is your eyes are going to be open to the gift of God, and you're going to begin to despise your life in this world. You're going to begin to want and hunger and thirst and desire the things that God has freely given to us by Christ Jesus so much that you'll do anything. And what God asks us is not hard at all. He just asks us to surrender all to him. He asks us, you know what he asks us? He asks us to trust him. That's where it all began. It all began with just simply God asking Adam, the man that he made and shaped and formed in his image and his likeness, to trust him. That's what it's all about. And then he even didn't make it very difficult. He said, listen, this is one, I'm going to give you all these trees. I mean, the Lord's like, imagine the Lord dividing up everything. You know, he said, one for you, one for me, one for you, one for me. He didn't. He said, all for you and one for me. You know, I'm going to give you these thousands of the trees of the garden, which are good for food. It's yours. I'm giving you all of this stuff. I put you in this paradise. You know, you act like God. When God has his choice over you, he's going to put you in some desolate wilderness. You're going to run around like a nomad, hoping that somehow you'll find some food somewhere. A scrounge some water or some drink. Isn't it? Father created men in the paradise. Hallelujah. He creates us in the paradise of plenty and of glory when we created anew in Christ Jesus. Come on. All that has to happen is your eyes got to be open, but you got to be careful because the cares of this world will choke you. Yeah. Listen, the cares of this world, the cares of this world are like thorns. They will choke you and keep you from ever producing fruit and bringing any fruit to perfection. You have a little old, hard, you know, ugly looking fruit. You know what I'm saying? Because you know how that, especially you'd be in Southern California, you know how citrus trees and other trees that are grafted, do you know how they grow? And when the thorn comes up from the stalk, then what happens to that orange tree? A little hard, just hard, ugly looking fruit, hard, ugly looking oranges that are so sour, you can't palate them. And that's what the Lord says. If you're going to get yourself involved with the cares of this world, you can quit trusting in the things that your own arm can provide. God said, cursed is the man who trusts in the arm of flesh for provision. That's what he said, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 6. I mean, you ought to read that and you ought to say, listen, I'm not going to trust in my own arm of flesh. He said, blessed is the man who puts his trust in the Lord and makes the Lord the sole object of his trust. This is what it's all about. It began with Adam. God said, don't touch this fruit. Forgive me. He said, don't eat this fruit. He said, it's mine. And, of course, Satan came along with his little message and twisted it all up, said, don't touch it. Neither shall we eat it. But the bottom line of it is, you know, Satan was able to just sow a little seed of propaganda. Oh, God is trying to keep something good back from you. He knows that the day that you eat thereof, you'd be like him. And he's just trying to hide something good from you. And begins to put within a person's spirit fear and question and insecurity. And then out of that, there becomes the overthrow of man. And everybody's reeling in it to this day. And here, along the way, we've had men like Abraham who fully trusted God. But you know, you're going to go through an evaluation too. You're going to go through a test too. And I pray that God would just heat, I pray that the coals of the fire of test would just get heated up for you. Amen. I pray you can't get comfortable. Said Peter said, many of you, he said, though you receive the end of your salvation, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Many of you are in heaviness right now because of many different kinds of tribulation so that you can start learning how to trust God. Turn me up. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to give you the abbreviated version right there quickly, verse 7. Many different types of diverse types of tribulations, trials, testings, evaluation. that the trying of your faith, which is much more precious than gold, though it be tried by fire, might be found unto praise, honor, and glory at the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. Understand that the Lord talks to the Laodiceans who think that they're all good to go. They're rich. They think that they're clothed. They think that they're well, you know, matured in the things of the Spirit by their description. He says they think that they can see and that they got a revelation and that they got insight and that they're really walking with God. He says, you blind, naked, miserable, wretched, and poor. I mean, you know, when the Lord lays it on you that way, you just better back up. You know, blind, wretched, miserable, naked, and poor. Are you listening to me? Are you, hello? I would hate for the Lord Jesus. I'd hate for the think that the Lord Jesus is looking at me right now going, you blind, miserable, wretched, poor, naked, Spitsbergen you. I would hate that he was looking at the abiding place ministry and saying, you blind, wretched, poor, naked, miserable. Come on. Church, the abiding place. Huh? He said, I counsel you to buy gold tried in the fire. He's talking about faith. Faith. He's talking about faith. He's talking about a trusting God on a level that you and I can now begin to represent him, because Father isn't interested in us representing him with our nice, you know, shiny cars and our well-built homes and our, you know, satisfying bank accounts and our wise investments. You know what I'm saying? That is just nuts. He wants us to represent him with silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Amen. He wants us to represent him with an authority that goes beyond anything that you and I could even begin to imagine at this moment in time. Back in the 1947, 48, and 49, a great revival swept across the United States of America. And in this revival that swept across the United States of America, here, I got some scriptures I'm going to read. Hey, come over here. Come here. How you doing tonight, sweet baby? Hey, are you gonna behave, Missy? Come on, I saw you running. You know, this morning I have sent a picture, and she's running with two doll babies under each arm, running for the little play cabin. I mean, it's like, come on, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let's have some fun. You know what I'm saying? Back in the 1947, 48, 49, there began to be a great sweeping move, a sovereign move of God and revival that we talk about in many terms. We refer to it as the latter rain revival. And that's just a means by which men try to communicate what's going on in God. Of course, Hosea chapter 6, verse 3, God says, I'll come to you as the early. You need some help. I'm going to give you two more months. And then we're going to boot camp. She's going to boot camp in 2 weeks. She's going to the ranch with Papa. And I guarantee you some serious changes are going to be taking place in her life.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Father, we just thank you for a right and proper spirit in Jesus' name. Hosea chapter 6 and verse 3 tells us that the Lord comes to us, and those are speaking of the sovereign movings of God as the early and the latter rain. James tells us that Father has a long patience. He's not going to come until he gets the fruit that he's looking for, that he's wanting, that he's laboring for. The husbandman is laboring for a fruit, and he's not coming until he gets that fruit, until he receives the early and the latter rain. James chapter 5, verse 7 connects Hosea 6, 3 for us so we can begin to understand a little bit about the things that God does. Father comes in the sovereign movings of his spirit to set us on the right track, to say, hey, heaven's better than... My life in heaven is better than my life on earth. And I can be living days of heaven right now. My citizenship is supposed to be in heaven. My conversation is supposed to be in heaven. My provision is supposed to be in heaven. That's called the faith realm. Man, when you walk in the faith realm of provision from heaven, you have everything that you have need of. The only reason that you may try to measure it in different respects, but you get everything. God will provide everything that you have need of. All you need to do is get more busy and activate in the kingdom so you have more needs if you want to see an increase in finances coming in. You know, that's just all there is. Father just takes care of us. But I want you to understand, there's a heavenly life right now. Our citizenship is in heaven. Our conversation is in heaven. We're seated in the heavenly realm. And the Lord says that we would have days of heaven upon the earth in Deuteronomy chapter 11 if we obey him. How much more now that the Holy Ghost has been poured out and we live now in this diamond dimension of grace in Christ Jesus, should we have days of heaven upon earth? And I watch people just struggling, living out their own life, just struggling with their own life. You're just running with your own life. And you don't know how to get Jesus into the context of your job. Your job rules you, not the kingdom. People don't go to, people, you're going to have to redefine the way you go to work, or you need to quit your work. You need to redefine the way you feel about your house, or you need to sell your house and give it to the poor. You need to redefine the way that you feel about your provisions in life, or you need to stop all of the provisions in life and begin to start anew with God and say, Father, I'm going to do exactly what you say in Matthew chapter 5. Chapter 5, 6, and 7, I believe if God's people would begin to live by simply living in a relationship with God based on Matthew 5, 6, and 7, your whole life would be radically changed. You've got to start taking heed of the Word of God somewhere. And all of a sudden, some people begin to get really uncomfortable when they hear preachers like me preach, because now they got to change. And the whole gospel is a gospel of change. Did you know that? Cartelage, or to reconciliation, is change. It is the gospel of change. Hallelujah. And it's great change. It's not bad change. You're not going from you to the devil. You're not going from earth to hell. Hey, listen, you're going from you into Christ Jesus and all the things of heaven has to provide. You're going from earth to heaven. Hello. You know, it's like the heroin addict sitting there saying, if I get saved, I'm going to have to give up too much stuff. And the alcoholic, the bum on the street, the person who's ruined his life with methamphetamines and marijuana and is just a loser anyways, he's sitting there all trembly because he's got so much to give up if he should turn his life over to Jesus. A lot of Christian people who are supposed to be matured in God act the same way about consecrating their lives and surrendering their lives and stepping into a greater commitment and trust to the Lord to step out. I know about this because I talk to all the folks out there who need human resources in the kingdom of God, and they say what Jesus said is absolutely true. And Mark, you're going to find more out about it as you try to, especially as you try to do missions, that listen, the harvest is plenteous and the labors are few. You're not going to find human resources that are going to, with abandonment, give their life to the kingdom of God. They're going to do their own stuff. Uh-oh. Hello. Yeah, I totally understand why you're silent. I totally understand why there's no giggles, no amens, no laughing, no praise the Lord, no hallelujahs, no shouting, no dancing. Because the truth sometimes is painful. The sobering realities. Huh? Hey, bless you. Praise God. I'm so glad you guys are making money for the kingdom. Go make more, because we need more. But the bottom line of it is, even if you make more and you put it all in the offering basket, we can't hire the dogs. You know what I'm saying? We can't hire the horses. We can't hire the cows to do the work of the ministry. We still got to look for somebody who's going to go do the work of the ministry. Amen. You know, we can't. Are you listening to me? Hello. Oh, everybody's got all these ideas, all these plans. People, come on. Somebody's going to have to put their hand to the plow and not look back. And it's going to cost you a change. You're going to have to learn how to trust God instead of trust yourself. Father wants to give you two hands for beginners right where you're at. He wants to help develop you right where you're at. He'll give you like a security blanket if that's what you need, so you can basically, you know, hold on to yourself until you're really, really, totally, fully willing to let go. People fast and pray just to have a breakthrough, to realize you're living your own life. Man, that's why the things aren't happening. That's why the New Testament signs and wonders and miracles aren't happening in your life. The Lord said, anyone who believes these works that I do, shall they do also in greater works. And he's talking about the type, kind, and quantity. He's not saying, he was talking to individuals. He wasn't talking to people collectively. He wasn't talking about technology. Jesus, help us. Oh, yeah, greater works because we got a television. Give me a break. And Jesus didn't have a television. He didn't do anything on the TV, okay? So it doesn't even qualify, you know? We got greater works because we have airplanes. Jesus didn't have an airplane. It doesn't qualify. Jesus is talking about the opening of the eyes of the blind, casting out of devils. He's talking about those are the works which he did. These works which I do, which testify the power and the glory of God, be made manifest through me. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, television, airplanes speak of the power and testify of the power and the ability of man, not God. Man, not God. Opening up the eyes of the blind, a person born blind, God. Causing the dead to raise from life again, to life again, God. Okay, those are the works that Jesus did. He's talking in context in John chapter 14, 11, 12, and 13 concerning the testimony of the divine miracles and signs and wonders being the proof that Father was doing the work through him, that it was Father who had sent him, that this was all about Father's purposes and Father's kingdom and Father's means of salvation for all humanity. And he says, anybody, anyone at all who believes. And I want you to understand what's embedded in that word believe. Trust. What's deeply embedded in that word is trust. faith. You know, Paul wrote his whole thesis on the just or the righteous shall live by faith based upon Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, which has for it, the word Hebrew word is emit, which is trust. So he takes that word trust of the Old Testament and he brings it over to the New Testament and he now baptizes it, we're in the Holy Ghost, trust baptized in the Holy Ghost, faith. Hallelujah. Yeah. And but the Lord described to us what faith is. He didn't. Faith isn't philosophical and ideological beliefs. He described to us what faith is. He said to us that faith is this. Faith is a man standing in front of him who is a centurion that says, I don't need you to come to my house. Speak the word only and I know my servant will be made whole. He said, that's faith. He says, faith is you'll speak to this mountain and you'll say, be thrown in or cast into the sea and it will obey you. And nothing shall be impossible for you if you believe what you say. This is what he calls faith. People call faith different things. But faith is the exploits of the supernatural power at work in our lives, demonstrating the power and the authority of a living God who created all the universe by his word. Hallelujah. And that's huge. Praise the name of Jesus. Now you can begin to warm up now. Maybe some of you need to dance a little bit because you're overwhelmed. You need to just get free. You need to just get free. You need to, you know, people, let me just tell you right now, the Lord has a key for your prison. You know, what you call security is actually a prison that you've made for yourself to live in. The Lord has a key so you can open up the prison door and come out here and just start roaming around out here in the glory and then start enjoying yourself in his presence and start flowing in the anointing and start, you know, calling in finances when you need them and hallelujah, multiplying a few loaves and fishes. Hallelujah. People who trust in uncertain riches will never be able to move into the faith to multiply loaves and fishes because it's such an absolute confidence and growth and maturity in the provision of God for you. And if you've been matured and developed in the provision of you for you, you're being trained wrong. That ain't going to work. You can't serve God and mammon. It ain't going to work. It's going to be a mixture. There's no way that you can be in that. It's a compromising situation. You're going to be of two judgments. Diakritos, wavering doubt. I'm just going to get over here and get sanctified. Well, I am sanctified. I'm going to live a sanctified life. That is a separated, set apart life to live by the Holy Ghost, the life of Jesus Christ. That's what sanctification is. The ability, hallelujah, because Father set us apart to live the life of Jesus Christ by the Holy Ghost. Say, Father set me apart.
Father set me apart.
How? To live the life of Jesus.
By the Holy Ghost.
And Jesus didn't have a music ministry. He didn't have all these things that we basically somehow define as living the life of Christ. Jesus lived the heavenly life, the God kind of life. He lived a life in complete trust upon the Father. Now, listen, did Jesus work for 30 years? Was he in submission to his parents at home for 30 years? He was. Is there a practical application inside of this? Yes. But what he did in all that time is he's growing and maturing in the wisdom and the knowledge of God. Scripture says he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. He was perfected. I mean, it's an amazing thing by the things which he suffered. Amazing things, you know. The captain of our salvation learned obedience. I mean, that's just radical. But what we see in his life is we see everything is about the Father. Everything is about the kingdom. We see it at the age of 12 years old. We understand his definition of what it means to be about the Father's will. Are you understand? Does everybody realize this? That Jesus defined for us at the time of his bar mitzvah what it meant to do to be about the Father's will. To be about the Father's business. And when he's there in the temple, and he's there in the place of ministry, just set apart, just telling all the things that were known to him of God and of the scriptures. And all of the wise and old guys and young guys are sitting around listening to him, astonished at his words. And his parents came looking for him and said, we sought everywhere for you. He said, why did you search everywhere? You should have known where I would be. Yeah. You don't know exactly where I'd be. I would be about my Father's business. God wants you to get about his business. He wants you to take everything that you have and put it into his hands. Listen, those of you who trust in uncertain riches, you're going to be disappointed. So quit trusting in them. Those of you who really put a lot of trust in your jobs, start committing to the Lord. Say, Lord, I don't want to trust in this job. In fact, I'm going to recognize that you gave me this job, and I'm never going to place my job above you and above the kingdom. I'm always going to seek first the kingdom and your righteousness. I'm going to put this in your hand. Anytime you want this, anytime you want me to leave this, anytime you want me to speak out on your behalf, which is all the time, I'm going to do so. I'm not going to hide and tremble trying to hold on to something that I have now somehow in my psyche and in the recesses of my thinking have made bigger than you have made my provision. You're going to make people, listen, I'm going to help you make everything in your life a provision directly from the Father that belongs to Him, that is in His hands, and that you don't need if he's leading you to do something else. That you're not holding on to for any other purposes. That there is no security there. Hello? Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if I ask the people of the churches across the United States, however many of you have security, do you find security within your job? If everybody was honest, they would raise their hand, and no one should. You should find security only in the provision of the living God who happened to give you that job, and it's His, and it's consecrated to Him, and He can have it anytime He wants it. Can you hear what I'm saying? Can you get your mind right? Can you get your spirit right? Can you start rightly dividing the Word of God in your own life? Can the Word of God begin to dominate you and rule you? Because the Word of God must begin to dominate us and rule us. The Word of God, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. If we're not willing to obey the Word of God, by default, you're in disobedience. Come on now. If you're not willing to trust God with total abandonment, you're missing out on the primary point. If you're how is it that you're going to have any kind of relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ that's going to grow and is going to develop into what Father has purposed it to be when you can't pass the first fundamental test of trust? How can you have a relationship with anybody you don't trust? I mean, His Word has built us up with so much confidence about all that He will do for us. I'm going to tell you, one of the chief characteristics of God is faithfulness. He will do whatever He's done. He will do what He promised to do. People that aren't receiving those things which God promised to do, I'm going to tell you right now, there's something that is in the way of your relationship with Him. There are some conditions of His Word that you're not willing to meet, and I guarantee you it's very fundamental and foundational to your relationship. And my job is to help you, to teach you, to perfect you, to help you understand how to begin to flow in the Holy Ghost in a greater way, how to begin to walk in the Spirit, depend upon the Holy Ghost, rely upon Him, how to hear from Him, how to be filled with confidence and boldness and faith and strength, how not to walk around in discouragement, disappointment, shame, and condemnation. Satan is a taskmaster. He rules and reigns within the realms of fear. And out of that comes all kinds of insecurity and all kinds of things that cause us people to live in the place of doubt. And the Lord has, and it's a place of fear, it's a place of bondage. I've come here to show you how to get out of fear, which has with it discouragement, which has with it condemnation, which has with it shame. I've come to show you how to come and stand before the living God without any sense of sin, to have no more condemnation, to have no more fear, to have no more intimidation, but rather to have the Holy Ghost on the inside of you crying out, God is my dad. Hello. God is my dad. I'm comfortable here. Satan's primary strategy with his work of fear to create shame and intimidation and insecurity and all those things that come out of fear is to try to keep you, to stop you, really, to block you from worshiping. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you still have to be holy to come into the holies of holies. But it's a gift. It's a gift of holiness that's given to us by Jesus Christ in the new creation. It's a gift of righteousness that has been given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ that is brought to us by the new creation. And so with this wonderful gift, we walk with all boldness into the holies of holies by the blood of Jesus Christ, which has cleansed us from all sin and given to us a sense and a consciousness of holiness. The offerer now once purged has no more consciousness of sin. Hallelujah. I mean, that's the whole thesis of Hebrews chapter 10. Said that we walk in now without any condemnation, where the Lord says, come on in. Those who are far away, those are near. Peace unto you, which is the opposite of condemnation. Relationship is perfect. Come on in. Hallelujah. But Yeah, if you're overwhelmed with intimidation, insecurity, and fear because of this thing and that thing, because you know yourself after the flesh and not after the spirit, because you've listened to all those lies, because you're overwhelmed with some failure, because you tripped up into something, or because you fell into something, but because of some temptation that came upon you that you did not know or understand how to stand against in God, and now Satan beat you down to the ground with it, and now your head is dropped and shame is all over you and condemnation is all over you. Satan's effectively keeping you from trusting in the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse you and keeping you effectively from that interaction that God has given to us that is something far more than just friends. It's oneness, you know. We find our whole self in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. It's amazing. All you're going to say is hallelujah. I mean, it's just amazing. He made us one. Father, I love it. One of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is Jesus saying, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them so they can be one just like we're one. And he's not talking about me and Joshua being one. He's not, because he says, Father, even as you are in me, I in them and they in me. You know, he's talking about our oneness in relationship with himself, not our oneness in relationship with each other. Our oneness in relationship with each other does not even exist in the context of John 17, 21 through 23. It's all about oneness with the Father, just as he's one with the Father. And you know, people would rather sit around and argue about the Trinity than understand the beauty of oneness. They'd rather sit around and argue whether or not the Holy Ghost comes on you and remains, or whether the Holy Ghost comes on you and lifts off, rather than understanding the beauty and the splendor of interacting with the Holy Ghost and flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. It's just nonsense. It's nonsense, and we're gonna have to get over ourselves. Hello. Has everybody gone to sleep?
No.
Just take a break. Or move your mouth with a smile or something. It's like, you know, do something. Just move. Just kind of just something that I know that you did not put a mannequin image of yourself in your seat and it slip out. And all I'm looking at is just Jesus. I know this is challenging. I know that people are sitting there trying to process in their mind, how am I going to put this into action in my life? And you should be. But the reality of it is that it needs to go even a little bit deeper. Holy Spirit, I yield myself to you. Teach me, lead me. Because we can't do these things with ourselves. See, Father has given to us everything that we need. We're without excuse. Father's given us everything we need. We're not going to stand, but you can't stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I didn't have what I needed. Pastor Mark, he had what he needed, but I didn't have what I needed. He was able to get it done because he had more resources. I didn't have the resources. No. Father has, on an even leveling field, given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness because he's called us to glory and virtue. Hallelujah. That's the opening statements in 2 Peter chapter 1. It's ours. These things have been given to us. I have an abundant and you have an abundant supply of the Holy Ghost. All you need to understand is how to tap into it. Did you know that you actually, Jesus described it, that the presence and the power and the life and the glory of God would be proceeding forth from you like rivers, like rivers, like rivers, like rivers. I mean, I think it would be just fine if the Lord would have said, I'm going to give you the expression of my life like a garden hose. That would have been amazing. Just like a little trickle. I mean, I'm going to give you a little trickle and it's going to be like a little percolator inside of you. He didn't. At the very least, he said, it's a wellspring. Hallelujah. It's a wellspring. And I'm going to tell you right now, that's an artesian spring. That's a flowing, and it's a flowing forth. And it's literally the bubble up. The Hebrew word for prophet is Navi. And it comes from the root word Nabo, which means to bubble up. It's this inspiration, hallelujah. It starts off with this, recognize who I am, Jesus says, to the most disqualified, most unqualified, a woman who'd been married 5 times and living with a man who was not her husband, in adultery, in other words. He said, recognize who I am and recognize that I have the gift of God. The gift of God is for you, and I will give you to drink in this context of you coming to know who I am and receiving the gift of God. And you will have a wellspring, an artesian well springing up on the inside of you. Huh? Producing the life of God. Producing eternal life, the life of God. Eternal life is defined and personified by Christ Jesus in 1 John. It's not just a quantity of time. It is a quality of life. It is the very life of God. Hallelujah. It's an ageless, it's an undiminishing life. And really, that's a proper way to translate it, both from the Hebrew language and the Greek language. It's undiminishing. It does not perish with the using. When you spend some of it, you still got just as much as you had before you spent it. It doesn't decay. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Hallelujah. And then the has to perinaya. And just to think that the Lord, talking about what he would do on the day of Pentecost in John chapter 7 and verse 38 and 39, said, oh, you're going to receive, I'm going to give you the gift of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to come in and ask me to drink, and you're going to have with on the inside of you a supply of the Holy Ghost that is on the level of rivers, the life of God flowing out of you by the Holy Ghost, just like rivers, not just like floods, like rivers, not like a wadi, a runoff in the rainy season, a continual flow. Well, what do you do to make that reality instead of fictional Christianity? Fictional Christianity would be a Christian philosophy or ideology that can never be realized in your human existence. It's not something that is a reality to you. The Word of God is true. It's power. It's living. It's spirit. It's life. It has the ability to produce within us the miracle that it describes. But there's a connectivity with it that must take place in our life. You know what that connectivity is? Faith. You know what that's about? Trust. It's about believing what God said. Yes. Amen. When you start believing some of the things that God said, you're going to get real happy. Yes. You're going to get so excited. You're going to get so full of thanksgiving. And as you do, you'll be so overwhelmed with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Because I'm going to tell you right now, he doesn't find doubt and sad and sorrowful people and hang out with them. Ain't no way. You wouldn't either. You ain't going to go hang out with that depressed, sorrowful, down, constantly, pessimistic, everything's bad and it's getting worse. Terrible. People, you're not going to go hang out with those people. You'd be depressed inside of a week. God, the Holy Spirit's hanging out with joyful people. He's hanging out with happy people, thanksgiving people, people who are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, and gives to us the ability to do it. He shows us how to do it. He passes by and shows you how to trust him. Hallelujah. And if you respond, then he just says, come on. Please, people. You have a wrong concept of God. Father, as it come down, he'd think, oh, that the Lord is going to come to us and meet us where we're at, in the sense that he's just going to hang out with us in our lowly place of misery and sorrow. He's in heaven. He invites us to come up into the realms of heaven. The Lord calls us. He calls us as we are. He does not accept us as we are. He changes us to be like him. That's what's holy and acceptable. That's what we live our lives to be. Holy and acceptable unto God. Thus, everywhere I read in the Word, the things that Father calls me to do, I say, yes, Lord, I want to do them. And I thank you, Father, that you empower me to do them. If I find myself fall, sin comes short of in some area through some temptation or from some ignorance or whatever, I just basically say, Lord Jesus, wash me, cleanse me in your blood. Thank you so much for your washing, for your cleansing, that you keep me by your power, that every stain of sin is removed by your precious blood. And I also say, Holy Spirit, strengthen me to now obey God perfectly and to do everything that you purpose for me to do. Because the Lord says, as you receive Christ Jesus, so walk in him. He says, be perfect as the Father in heaven is perfect. He tells us to be holy even as he is holy. He tells us to walk even as he walks. He tells us to live even as he lives. He tells us to purify ourselves even as he is pure. If that's not enough for you, I can keep going. Because the Lord brings us into the same relationship that he has with the Father and calls us into the same glory. Somebody said, be holy as he is holy. Oh, that's just so much work. I mean, how does God ever expect that we could ever do such things? I mean, we're just so bent on evil and iniquity. We just love, just hating and devouring and cussing and lying and cheating and stealing and murdering so much, How does God ever expect? Reality of it is, dear people, Father has come to bring and brought us his life. So that we can begin to understand the abundant life and recognize how the power of the Holy Spirit empowers us with the ability to do these things. People act like they're going to do it. You can't do nothing. Of yourself, you can do nothing. The only thing that you're doing of yourself, all that you're doing of yourself is hurting you, not helping you. It's a struggle. It's depression. Ask the dentist. They've been creating more protective teeth gear for people chewing on their teeth at night. They're gnashing. There's weeping and gnashing of teeth going on everywhere. Like people are grinding their teeth down from stress like never before. It's pretty hectic. Yeah. The majority of people on the face of the earth are depressed because they feel they have a sense of failure. They're not good enough. They don't feel good enough. They don't feel like that they're good enough at work. They're good enough at school, or good enough in sports, or good enough as a husband, or good enough as a wife, or good enough as a parent. Just walking around feeling like, not good. I'm a loser. Depressed, sorrowful, beaten down, cast. And this is the world. And then are you now you gonna add to that trying to please God? Yeah, add to that being holy even as He's holy. Without holiness, you cannot see God. Listen, it's a gift. It's an empowerment. It's a relationship. It's come hang out with the Papa. It's come stay over here in the heavenly realm. You know how many verses of scripture I gave you tonight already? I gave you more already than you could have possibly had the time to look up and read. I'm saturating you with the Word of God. Amen. Praise God, it's on the YouTube. You can go and look it up, man. You have to get yourself a computer to keep up. You'll have to hit pause. You'll have to hit pause and play over and again. But if you do, if you'll be so noble as to want to get the Word of God and to prove in you and to prove that these things that I'm telling you are true, then what's going to, the beautiful reward out of it is that now that this Word of God is going to be on the inside of you, the Word of Christ can dwell in you richly. Hallelujah. The Word of Christ dwells in you richly because you're being filled with the Spirit. They're hooked up to one another. Dear people, when the Word of Christ dwells in you richly, all you walk in the light as He is in the light, and you have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all sin. It's an ongoing cleansing. It's a continual keeping, being kept by the power of God. The Holy Spirit's giving you insight, the Spirit of wisdom and revelation. And you're coming to know how valuable you are to the Father, or what is His riches, or what is His inheritance in you, His saints. What are the riches of His inheritance in you, His saints? And as you begin to know how valuable you are to the Father, how that you are a precious, expensive, costly treasure to Him. Huh? La mombra de Shepayahala. Jewels, as it were, in His crown. And begin to understand the value that He's placed upon us, His saints, calling us. Saints literally means holy ones. Hagiosmos is a holy ones. We are holy ones, saints. So to be sanctified is to be those of who belong to holiness. Praise God. It's a gift. It's a gift. You know, that's what Paul wrote to everybody in the church. He writes to the saints at Ephesus, to the saints at Philippi, to the saints at Colossae. He writes to the saints. These things are for the saints. Saints, 62 times in the New Testament, twice Christians. We saints. We the holy ones. Hallelujah. Ephesians 4:24, He's made us in righteousness and true holiness. If we're walking around, we're understanding these wonderful things, and they're just there in our hearts, and we're being constantly reminded and brought in to an understanding of God's keeping power and of God's provision for us. Then all of a sudden what's going to happen is faith is going to be built up and confidence is going to be built up, and we're going to have a mind that thinks differently. So therefore we won't be conformed to the world, but we'll be transfigured by thinking different about ourselves, because the Word of God is here abiding on the inside of us. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty. There's no greater weapon than the sword of the Word of God. The weapon of our warfare that are not carnal and mighty, it's God power. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal but God power. To get our minds and our thoughts thinking in the way in which the knowledge of Christ Jesus has been delivered to us about who we are and what God has given to us and what He's empowered us to do and what He's empowered us to be. Yeah. And, you know, one of the things that I do, you know, I'm just wanting to just move deeper into the operation and giftings of the Holy Ghost. I just keep before me all the scriptures, verses of scriptures. On the gifts of the Spirit and the baptism and the Holy Ghost, the work and the operation of the Holy Ghost in my life. Just keep it in front of me. If it's healing, if there's healing that is needed in my life, just keep all the healing scriptures in front of me. Just let the Word of Christ dwell in me richly. It's going to produce within me faith. Hallelujah. So faith comes by the Word, you see. Otherwise, what's going to happen, you're going to be caught up in the cares of this world, and it's going to teach you how to live by sight. Live by perception. I've watched so many people, a crowd of people there maybe I was with many, many years ago. Many of them had just left behind. They didn't win it. They weren't willing to go on in God. They cultivated responding to this life and living their life out of perceptions. That's what it means to live by sight, to walk by sight, to live out of your own perception, the hearing of the ear, the seeing of the eye, the thinking of the logic, rational conclusions of men, rather than to live by faith. How do you live by faith? You live by faith, but from one way, by one means, the word. For faith comes by the word, hearing the word of God. That's where faith comes. So that we therefore, as Paul said, don't look on those things or don't respond to those things which are seen, but we look on or respond to those things which are unseen, because those things which are seen are temporal, but those things which are unseen, which are revealed to us by the word of God, they are eternal. And that's what our response is. Our response is to the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord of Roshika. Papa took them into the wilderness that they may learn that man does not live by bread alone, but by the word of God. So he took them through all kinds of trials and situations. He took them to the place where they were so thirsty that their tongue was swelling in their mouth. And their legs probably were starting to swell. And the parents were saying, my kids are about to die. And then when they get to the place that the Lord was bringing them, where there is water, so everybody's all excited. Yippee, we're finally at water. God's led us to water. He is merciful. He is faithful. He is just. He is good. And they take a sip of the water, and it's bitter. And now they're ready to stone Moses. And if God would have been there, they would have stoned him. Because however you feel about the leader is how you feel about Father. Just the way it works. Because they all tied up, both in terms of activity and works and also within the thinking and analysis of men's minds and understanding. This is proven again and again. Hallelujah. You listen to me, because you won't get built up with the Spirit here tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Only one person was willing to see the cross. Only one person was willing to see the provision. And God showed him a tree. That's what the scripture says. And God showed him a tree, and he took the tree and he cast it into the bitter waters, and the bitter waters were made sweet, and everybody drank. Because one person was able to stand back and see and behold the provision of the living God. One person was able to count God faithful. One person was able to hook up with him and trust him. One person was willing not to waver. One in the camp. The statistics. Sometimes I encourage myself with the statistics of the Bible. I think about all the thousands that Jesus preached to and then how many people were with him at the end. You know what I'm saying? I think about the statistics of the Bible, how Father worked with men and there was only Noah. He's got Noah. There's millions of people. They were living in interacting with angels. The Garden of Eden was still on the earth. All the imaginations of men were wicked continually. God finds Noah. And by default, those who are in his house were saved. It's just like with Lot. You know, God says, can I find, you know, Abraham brings all the way down to 10. And the angel almost had to drag Lot out of there. He said, go get your son-in-laws and your daughters and all your possessions. He couldn't get any of them. When he went and told them that the God was getting ready to destroy the city, they looked at him like he was joking. That's literally what the scripture says in the Hebrew language. They looked at him like he was joking, telling a joke. Ha ha, you nuts. Only ones he was able to save were those who were immediately in his house that he could lay hold on. And they were reluctant. His wife and two daughters. Sit. Four. One. One. Lot was sitting out in the gate, looking out, contemplating. Not in the city, beholding what was happening in the streets, but outside the gate. One. God finds one man, Job. One. Devil says, everybody's following me. God says, I got one. That's amazing. You know, Papa should be ashamed. He's only got one person in his church. He must not be a God-honored church. He's got one person in his congregation. Huh? He must not be preaching the Bible right, properly, or something. You know what I'm saying? One person in his church. Satan says, everybody's following me. God says, I got one. I got one man. That's all I need is one. He had one champion, Job. He's perfect and is righteous in all of his ways. Somebody said, there's none righteous, no, not one. Don't twist the scripture. Don't misapply the scripture. Because it's a twisting of scripture, because there have been many righteous, Job being one of them. God called three men in the Old Testament perfect, tamim. The Hebrew word is tamim, without blemish. Without blemish, perfect. Tamim. Not tahor, but tamim. Tahor is the opposite of tamim. Tamim, perfect. Three men, perfect. Here we are, now baptized in the Holy Ghost, not finding a power and ability to walk with God. We should be ashamed, as the Jewish mama said. You should be ashamed. Now, Papa's given us all things that we have need of. Amen. He's given us everything that we have need according to his divine power. By his divine power. That's a lot of power. According to his divine power, or by the working of his divine power. He's given us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness. I've got every dimension of the life that I need, the life of God, to live the life that God has purchased for me to have. When Jesus took my sins in his own body on the tree, and he put to death sin in his own body. He bore my sins in his own body on the tree, that now me being dead, cut off from sin, might live unto righteousness, by whose stripe, whose wounds I was healed. That with the heart man may now believe into righteousness. There's so much false doctrine and heresy being taught and gobbled up in this day and time, where everybody says, oh, we're unrighteous. They are literally believing with the heart unto unrighteousness. That is Antichrist spirit. That is twisting the scripture and making it the opposite. We believe with the most important verse of scripture in Romans, Romans 10, 9 and 10. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. To recognize that the beautiful thing that God did for us in Christ Jesus was give to us the gift of righteousness, the gift of the righteousness of God. He who knew no sin became the sin offering, that we through him might be made the righteousness of God. How would we reject that? Only a satanic lie that would begin to twist and create another identity, another likeness, another word contrary to the word of God. And Paul said, if anybody teaches anything contrary to that which I've taught to you, let him be accursed. Even if it's an angel, let him be cursed. Let him be cut off unto the coming of the Lord. Anathema, Maranatha. I mean, these are radical things, isn't it? But yet, people have got itching ears. They won't endure sound doctrine. They don't want to hear this wonderful way of walking in the Spirit and living out this life of God that we've been empowered to do, because they're entangled with the world. They're entangled with the cares of this life. And to begin to believe these things which God has most perfectly put before us, all of a sudden it's going to demand radical change. But it's good change. Hallelujah. God isn't calling you to be a hermit living in a cave somewhere, basically, you know, beating yourself with sticks and flogging yourself with whips and cutting yourself with glass and eating spiders and worms or something. I don't know. It's just like sometimes when we talk about this life of losing your life that you might have his life, people kind of like have that response because they're listening too much to the spirit of this world, the God of this world, the spirit of disobedience, rather than hearing the Holy Ghost tell us and paint for us the grandeur, picture of majesty and splendor that exists within the life of Jesus Christ. His life. Hallelujah. Tonight I want the yoke to be broken off of you. I want shame to be broken off of you. I want your own human psyche and consciousness and oppression of self-identity and who you think you are and what you purpose to be, because you've lived so long by the arm of flesh. All you can know yourself is after is your own human ability, and that is so depressing. And it can never please God, and it can never be what God has described us to be. You're going to have to forsake living by your own ability, living by your own human ability. No flesh of glory in his presence. Have you begun in the Holy Ghost now to be made perfect by your own ability, by the flesh? God forbid, there's absolutely no way. Having begun in the Holy Ghost, you're made perfect by the Holy Ghost, and you're going to have to fully get over here and throw in all in the kingdom of God, and take no thought, don't be concerned about what you shall wear, and don't be concerned about what you shall eat. Hallelujah. I'm not concerned. Say, I'm not concerned. Hallelujah. Proto say. The other night, Heather gave the last bit of finances she had in the offering. And she was telling me about that. I said, well, I know. You don't have to tell me anymore, because I know what the result of that is. If you emptied the purse, when you emptied the purse in the offering basket, you need to tell me what's going to happen. Blessing of God's going to fall. It does every time. And the emptying of the purse can be two mites. Somebody said, oh, I can give two mites, no problem. Anybody give two mites. Well, that's everything you have. But I have an abundance. I can't give it all because it's too much to give. I guarantee if you had two mites, you might give God a quarter mite. Huh? Because you have eight quarters, you give him one. And you keep the other because you figure out how it is you can make it by until you get another mite. You're good to me, listen to me. The offering isn't so much anymore but worshiping God. Worshiping God with abandonment of heart. It isn't about all the other things that people make it. It's really about worshiping with the total abandonment of your heart. Your whole life is supposed to be about, you know, the reactions and the responses to crises, the response that you have to, you know, tough circumstances, challenging situations. Is an opportunity to worship. It's an opportunity to step out and trust God and say, Father, I know it's going to be fine. You know, my wife and I, we have this thing that we say. It's just simply, you know, when the crunch comes down, and I guarantee you, the more you get yourself out in the place of being responsible for more in the kingdom of God, which usually is equated to more finances, hey, you know what? You're going to have to be prepared for that, because if you're not, you're going to die of stress. You die of a stroke in the middle of the night. You just have a heart attack or something. We just say, it's Father's. It's all his Papa's. Let's watch what he's going to do. He's going to take care of it. Let's just watch what God will do. He's going to work a miracle. And then we just go on about it and not think about it again. It's his. And if the buzzards try to come, fly around on this offering, I just beat them off, man. Get out of here. Father, thank you so much for your provision, you know. And we've watched the Lord do phenomenal, miraculous things in every dimension of our life, just as he said, hallelujah, in every dimension of provision, in every dimension of protection, in every dimension of perfection, every dimension of the gift of salvation. It touches every part of our life, hallelujah. It's his life. He wants to be the one in charge of our life. Will you let him be in charge of your life? It begins with you being willing to obey his word. That's simple, that practical. It begins with you being willing to bless those who curse you. Ha! Smile and wave at those people who are just blowing their horn and you know, turning on and off their brights on the highway because you don't even know what you did. And you smile and you wave. Whatever. Blessing those who curse you. Doing good to them who despitefully use you. Loving those who hate you. Because then you're finding yourself in a place of where that now responses of self-preservation and fear and intimidation. You just now mess with me and I'm the most important person to me. Who do you think you are treading upon my sacred ground, as it were, of my life? You know, the whole thing that goes on in us that we don't really understand, but it's such the pride of life. The most subtle of all Satan's tricks. We just stop and say, no. Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, fill me with the love. I yield myself to you. Fill me with joy. Yes. Help me to see this the way you see it. Let me just bless. Yes. I want to dwell in you. He that dwells in love dwells in God, you know. Yes. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and be filled with all the fullness of God. What a price to pay. All I got to do is not get into a silly little three-year-old fight with this person, and I can have the potential of yielding to the love of God and have the fullness of God function operating my life. I can move on in the blessings of God instead of sitting back in the depression and the sorrow and the curse of my own, you know, self-interest. People trade in the beauty and the splendor that has been freely given to us in Christ Jesus for such cheap, ridiculous nothings. You know, I mean, what should it profit a man if he gained the whole world but lose his own soul? Well, that's one thing. What should it profit a man if he gained some little teeny trinket in exchange for his soul? You know, come on. He gives his whole life to depression, sorrow, and agony in exchange for his soul. Round and around, grinding meal for the Philistines. Eyes plucked out, hair cut off. Just another day at the mill. They're saying, Papa's looking for champions. Amen. Yeah. Father's purpose, greatness upon our lives. Yeah. There's ever there time in the history of men that there needs to be champions. That there needs to be men and women of greatness. It's now. Yeah. A little bit earlier, I began to talk to you just a little bit, just mentioning the revival of what we call the Latter Rain Revival in 47, 48, 49. The miracle healing revival when William Branham came on the scene and everybody who was sick in the place got healed. Everybody who was a paraplegic walked. Everybody who was blind saw, everybody was deaf heard. I mean, just such radical volumes of miracles that nobody could deny it. It went radically solid for 2 years. Extraordinary miracles that just began to just then ultimately be multiplied in other men of God as they watched William Branham from T.L. Osborne to others as he functioned in this anointing, Jack Cole, the list goes on. And ultimately, them standing there in this revival, and it looked like the works of Jesus. For about a year to 2 years, it really looked like the works of Jesus. It was powerful. I mean, just all the miracles of the New Testament were taking place. And they began to prophesy that soon there was to come another great revival would come, another great outpouring of the Holy Ghost would come, another great time in which the Lord came in the moving of His sovereign power. And in that move of God, there would be the greater works. And now, understand me, you know, men are fallible in their prophecies, and I recognize that it doesn't have to be limited to, you know, the works this time, the greater works next time. But Father does have to work with His church to produce within us a place of responsiveness and faith and following on to know Him, because that's what it's about. That's what Hosea says in 6:3. He has come to us as early in the latter rain, the sovereign movements of God, that he may know those who follow on to know Him. And if Father doesn't have anybody in this earth to cooperate with Him, He's not going to be able to show His signs and wonders and miracles. It takes somebody that's willing to leave everything. Praise God, Peter was willing to leave everything. Amen. Huh? Yeah. And I can go on the list. I can go on the list. On down the list. People, I'm going to just tell you right now. If folks act like it just ministers, certain anointed ministers who flow and function, operate in the gift of Spirit. No, it's not. It's just those are the ones who are doing it all the time. The rest of you busy at work or shopping or recreating or vacationing or whatever it is. If you would continually give yourself to the things of the Spirit, you would grow strong and mature in the giftings and the anointings and the manifestations of the Spirit as well. You're not going to learn sitting on your couch doing, you know, feeling bad about yourself. You can learn sitting on your couch praising the Lord. And giving thanks, worshiping Him, letting faith begin to build in your life. Prayer will begin to work powerful. Powerful prayer will begin to work powerful faith in your life. Hallelujah. Sitting around praying, feeling bad about yourself, huh? Praying the prayer of doubt ain't going to do nothing. Huh? Praying the prayer of doubt and unbelief. Praying the prayer of doubt and complaint, you know? It's just, come on. I brought the day and I'm believing for a change for you tonight. I'm believing for a miraculous shift tonight. I'm believing that God would show you the beauty and the splendor of Jesus so that in the beauty of His glory, you will abhor yourself.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you, even the great men of God, once they had another encounter with God, abhorred themselves. Huh? Job had many encounters with God, but there came one glorious encounter with God in Job 38 that he abhorred himself. Huh? He saw the beauty and the splendor of who God was. Hallelujah. Isaiah had a great anointing upon him, was the mouthpiece of the Almighty. Then he stood there in the holies of holies and behold the glory, and he said, I'm unclean. Huh? I'm unclean. Depart from me. When he saw the beauty and the splendor of the living God, suddenly all of his beauty was turned into shame. His comeliness turned into corruption, as it were. In contrast and comparison, all you need to do is see Jesus. Yeah. And you'll leave everything else, but all the rest of the stuff become ugly. It'll become ash ugly. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And He'll give you beauty for ashes.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And the oil of joy for mourning. Go in and yield to the Holy Spirit when you're mourning, when you're complaining, when you're depressed, when you're sorrowful, when you're overwhelmed. Go to the rock, Christ Jesus. Go to the rock and speak to the rock and say, Rock, give me some water. And the water will flow out.
Yes.
And the water of the Holy Ghost, when you drink this water, ooh, it'll do more than refresh you. Huh. It'll do more than revitalize you.
Yes.
Danny and I were out working. We was out working up in Redding the other day. It must have been 110 degrees. And it was so dry, still hot. And you run out. You don't drink water for a couple of hours and that, and you start feeling faint and weak. And trembly. Drink the water and all you refresh. You're ready to go back at it again. Huh? This water produces something far greater than refreshing. This water produces the very life of God in an unlimited fashion. It's about time you drink. It's more than a giggle. It's more than a roll. It's more than a shout. It's more than a holler. It's more than a hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just looking. I'm here tonight just looking for a breakthrough. Okay. Mind if I just, I'm hovering over you with the Word of God. You know the Holy Ghost is hovering over you. He wants to bring something beautiful out of your chaos. You know what I'm saying? He hovered over the face of the deep. Hallelujah. He brooded over it. He hovered over it. He moved over it. Merachechet. He brooded, hovered over it. I want you to be built up in the faith. I want you to be confident in God. If you can't be confident and bold in God, you never do nothing. And you're never going to be confident and bold in God until you learn how to trust Him with your life. And the more you put your life on the line, the more that you begin to deal and define in the reality of your heart where you're at. I just pray every one of you have an opportunity to go to some nation that's threatening to kill you if you come.
Amen.
If you come, if you come here and preach the gospel, we're going to kill you. I pray that every one of you have the glorious opportunity. Go do that.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And let the Spirit of the Lord so fill you with confidence and boldness in that place of total abandonment. You never go back. But you're going to have to start two hands for beginners. Hey? Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Two hands for beginners. Can you trust Father with your circumstances?
Yes.
Can you trust Father with your problem? Can you cast all your cares upon Him because you know He cares for you so that you don't worry about it anymore? Huh? Don't concern yourself with it. Don't worry about anything, but with prayer and supplication, make your request known unto God. Amen.
Amen.
With thanksgiving. Hallelujah. What a change that would happen, make in your life. You'd be happy all day long. You'd spend your whole life, every day rejoicing. You'd wake up in the morning, say, this is a day that the Lord has made. You'd grab your stuff and say, let's go have fun. Amen. Hallelujah. Ese bero. Ese beredoshi. Ese beredoshi paranea. Ese beredoshi paranea prost. Where's Anna? What's she doing in that kid's church? She needs to be in this church here. Who's doing kid's church? I didn't know they did that on Wednesday night. I thought all the kids were supposed to be in here Wednesday night. I got to have one night with them. Yeah, I'd rather you didn't do that. You know, I'm sure they're doing a good job, but I mean, at the same time, just incorporating everybody into the midst of the body of Christ, into the church, into the assembly of the church together at least one night out of the week is very important to me. Oh, by the way, this Friday night, I'm going to do a study on end time prophecy. I'm going to do one night on end time prophecy. On the rise of the empire of the 10 kings, from which the Antichrist or the 7th kingdom arises, from which then the 8th kingdom. It's all right, sweetie. It's all right. It's all right. Thanks, though, for being so responsive. I appreciate that so much. You know, because there's many times I've expressed my will to certain people that I really feel strong about it and nothing changes. And it is like, okay, well, it's too late now. But, you know, I do appreciate that responsiveness. Say, okay, well, we'll fix this right now. Pastor wants this, and we're going to do it. Amen. Because that's the way you move on with God. That's the way you move on in the things of the Spirit. If you just sit by and go, nothing's going to ever happen to you. You're going to have to be aggressive. The violent take the kingdom by force. They're aggressive. It's an aggressiveness. I cannot live without these things in the Spirit of God. But I don't think there's a lot of people that know much about the rise of the empire of the 10 kings, from which the Antichrist rises up out of the little horn, and which is the 7th kingdom and the 8th kingdom. So I'm going to spend some time with it. I'm just finishing up a book on the rise of the 7th and the 8th kingdoms. It's 20 chapters, ends with the collapse, the total collapse of society as we know it. And so I just encourage you to come. It's you can understand. I want you to have a clarity of what's going to happen in the future. People today right now are trying to, and I'm just tell you why I'm doing this. People today are trying to say that the eighth kingdom is being seen. It's just so ridiculous. And saying ISIS is the eighth kingdom. It's just so ridiculous. Mohammedism started in the 7th century A.D. Hello. It had nothing to do with the religion of the kingdoms of the past. Five had already fallen in the day of John. Day of John. You understand? The whore represents, that's riding the beast, represents the religion that was a part of all those seven kingdoms. You understand me? Yes. Hello? You understand what I'm telling you?
Yes.
It's just this ridiculous nonsense. I don't even understand what you know, what book people are reading. But then they present themselves as people who understand end time prophecy, and they say these ridiculous things that are so foreign to the scripture. And I feel that, so what happens is this. People start crying wolf so much that the sheep no longer respond to the warning. And furthermore, you violate the truth to a degree that it's almost no longer relevant. And so there's got to be voices. I'm just praying that all of you understand the things that we're doing and the value of what we're doing. The enemy might try to marginalize people and to make things look small. I'm going to tell you right now, he never wins. God always takes people that Satan fights against and tries to marginalize them, and he makes sure that his work that he's purposed to do through them is accomplished. And so we just want to encourage you to be a part of what God's doing in this place. We really believe in the things that God is doing through our lives.
Yes.
We're absolutely, I'm like the biggest supporter of the ministry that God's placed in my life. I'm the biggest supporter of the anointing. And I believe totally in the giftings and the callings of God.
Amen.
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 And we want you guys to get in a relationship, every one of you get in a relationship with the Lord where you just like living the best life.
Yes.
And then understand that the Lord take that best life and promote it to abundant life, because abundant life is still better than the best life. Living the God kind of life.
Amen.
You cease to live the human. The life is mere men. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he says you behave yourself and live as mere men. That's what he said. You walk carnally, saying, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Paul, I'm of Cephas. Great leaders, great people to follow. I'm telling you right now, that would be a good church to be in any one of those three. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Peter's church or Paul's church or Apollo's church. Great. He said, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. You behave yourself. You behave yourself after carnal reasoning and carnal thinking and after human perceptions and human preferences. This is about Jesus. This is about the moving of the waters, the Spirit. It's about the moving the power of the Holy Ghost. About living in the kingdom of God and understanding something far bigger than what goes on in the framework of what God does through men, and understanding and interacting with God himself.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Stand with me. Stand with me. Let the weak say I'm strong. Let the sad say I'm happy. Let the poor say I'm rich. Let the sorrowful say I'm joyful, full of joy. Hallelujah. Let the downcast say, I'm seated in heavenly places and walking upon my high places in God. Just begin to prophesy over yourself the word of God, not the word of men, not your hopes and dreams, but God's vision for your life. Without a vision, the people perish. And the only vision that we want is a heavenly vision. You know what Paul said? Paul described the heavenly vision. I don't believe that there are many heavenly visions. I believe there's only one heavenly vision. That heavenly vision was fully revealed to us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul received a heavenly vision, and as he gave his defense to Festus, King Agrippa and Festus, he said, I have not been unfaithful to the heavenly vision. He said, this is the heaven, and he described the heavenly vision. He said, I saw Jesus on the road to Damascus, and he gave to me power to turn people from Satan to God, from darkness to light, to open the eyes of the blind. That's the heavenly vision. Where you begin to step, come on, dear people, just begin to step out in a place of boldness and confidence in God because of who he's made you to be in Christ Jesus. With all the riches of his goodness that has been supplied to you by the power of the Holy Ghost. Begin to see yourself after the manner of the Word, as the Word of God has described you, and not after the way that you perceive yourself to be. Huh? Don't have a veil over your face. Don't have a veil over your face where you can't see the new covenant. Okay? Take the veil off and look in the mirror. What will you see? Is that what we're going to see? Is that what we're going to see? Huh? Are you just going to throw yourself down in the middle of the Holy Ghost meeting and have a temper tantrum? People, this message that I'm ministering to you tonight was not rehearsed in earth. It was given out of heaven.
Amen. Yeah!
It's Father's message to you. Amen. It's what Father's saying to you.
Yeah.
You just hear. Hearken and do it. All the blessings are yours. It's just that simple. Simply obey God's word and the great miracles of faith happen. Listen to this. The smallest acts of obedience, listen to me, the smallest acts of obedience will create the greatest miracles of faith. Small acts of obedience, call upon the name of the Lord Jesus and you shall be saved, produced the greatest miracle of faith. In every dimension of that which God supplies to us works the same way. Woo-hoo. He's made it so easy. Papa's made it so easy. See, God, and the Bible say that. I pray in the name of Jesus that every one of you be encouraged, that you recognize encouragement comes from the Holy Ghost, and that you will strongly have an authority to rebuke discouragement, that discouragement comes out of the realms of darkness. Don't yield your members to discouragement. Don't do it. Yield your members to encouragement. Yield your members to righteousness. Yield your members to what God the Holy Ghost is. Don't yield your members to sorrow and sadness and depression. Yield your members to joy and rejoicing and thanksgiving. Yield your members as instruments of righteousness unto holiness. Yielding yourself to what God said we're supposed to do, how God said we're supposed to live, and how Father said we're supposed to act. Having this witness and this testimony and this evidence of the Holy Ghost in your life. Hallelujah. Jesus. I love you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we praise your holy name. We thank you for the life you've given. We thank you for the life you've given. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the life you've given. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the life you've given. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the life. Thank you, thank you, Jesus, Lord of heaven. Thank you, Jesus, Lord of earth. Thank you for the life. For the life you've given, and I will walk with you in the light of your life, Lord. We will walk with you in the light of your life. Oh, worship the Lord. We worship you. Rejoicing, oh, we worship you,
life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for this life. Abundant, abundant life. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this life. Abounding life. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Ha ha ha.
Something, you know, just bless him with something, honor him with something that's important to you. Somebody gave their shoes, you don't really need to do that. We appreciate that, but just honor the Lord with the stuff that you have, because he's going to take and give you, he's going to multiply whatever you give to Father. He, whatever you give to him in righteousness and holiness and purity, he takes the takes that and he multiplies it in your life. Give him everything.
Give him everything, because he wants you to have all that he has. Give him everything. Tonight, if you need prayer for anything, if you're sick in your body, if you're sick in your heart, maybe there's somebody here, you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You never called out to him and said, Lord, come save me, come deliver me. Listen, by the name of Jesus, the miracle of salvation takes place, and anyone who's willing to call out to him, you may not even understand even a fraction of what this is about. You may not understand even a fraction of who Jesus is and what he means to us. But the power and the authority that is in his name will result in the power of the Holy Ghost coming upon you, changing you into a new creation, giving you a new heart and a new spirit. Father, make everything brand new. Everything old will pass away, and behold, everything will become new. Everything will be of God. If you're just hurting, are you uncertain? Maybe somebody in this place tonight, you've been walking with God in the past, but you've not been walking with him right now. You used to understand what it was like to flow and operate in the gifts of the Spirit and how beautiful it was to live your life walking in the Holy Ghost, being led by the Spirit. You lost that burning fire of divine glory. You lost that passion that only the Spirit of the Lord can produce. Father's here to strengthen you, touch you, renew you, bring it all back and more. All you have to do is submit yourself to Him. Respond to Him. Take your life and present it before Him. And He'll cause His fire to come upon it. He'll baptize you in His glory. He'll change everything. He'll take your darkness and take it and change it. And you'll be living in the light. He'll take your sorrow, turn it into joy. He'll take the bad, the problems, erase them and remove them from out of the way and fill your life with every good thing is what He's promised to do. Any kind of problems in your spirit, any problems in your body, if anybody has any disease, even just a virus, pain or aches in your body, the Lord's here to touch you. I mean, it's hard to enjoy the things of the Lord if you've got a bunch of pain in your body. And Father's given us authority over pain, sickness, and disease to remove it. Just come. Come, let the Lord touch you. Come, test Him out here tonight. The Lord says, come test me out. Come prove me. Hallelujah. Allie and come pray. Just walk down to here and begin to pray for people. Hallelujah. And come. Thank you, Jesus. Just let the Lord touch you. You're meeting here with Him. I'm going to come by and minister to you. Just let Papa touch you. You just talk to Him.